when we introduced attacks by malware, we mentioned that malware is not only a problem for computer systems and laptops, it's also a problem for mobile systems. So now we want to have a look to mobile apps and malware. Let's start with remind you there are two popular operating systems for mobile systems. There's on the one side the Android operating system and on the other side the iOS system. And for both operating systems, there exist huge platforms where the users of that operating system can download apps. This is Google Play for the Android operating system, and it's Apple's App Store for the Apple's iOS. And these platforms become more and more important. There is a huge amount of apps that could be downloaded from that platform. So here a number from last year, from March 2017, almost 3 million apps which could be downloaded from the Google Play Store. And there are more than 2 million apps that are available in the Apple's App Store. Here is some illustration of which version of this operating system are used. So the early versions are, of course, much more insecure than the new systems. And here you see, when we look, for example, to Android, the last version are the 8, the version 8. There is not very much distributed. Here the older versions, 5 to 7. This is the biggest amount of people that are using this state of the operating system. And the same is true for the iOS system. Here is the latest version. It's used by half of the people, a little bit more than half of the people, and former the amount of people that use former operating system versions are relatively large. And this has consequences for the security. So one should update the system on the latest version. But in the context of mobile systems, that's not easy. That's not easy because some of the vendors have a add to the operating system, which they use some functionality, an additional functionality. So if there is a new update of the operating system, this will not work for the additional functionality. So such vendors only provide updates not fast enough. Some basic concepts. Basic concept, how such an app comes to such an app store, and how, what are the controls which are behind. So the publication of an app is everyone, every developer around the world is invited to develop apps. And what the developer must do to put the app which is developed by him to such an app store, he must log in to the respective store. And then the app are electronically signed by the developer, so that's clear and cannot be faked that the app come from this person or this company. This is done to prevent, also to prevent unintentional changes. And then the store operators become active. They start to review the app. And particularly, they look for malicious behavior, whether there are some malware hidden or some malfunctionality in this app. And then the app, if they have managed all this test, then the app are published and are available for download from the platform. The apps on the systems, on the mobile devices, run in separate environments. So an unauthorized access of to the data or to other apps is in this way prevented. So using one app, it's not possible for that app to access data or to do some interaction with other apps. Of course, there are some defined interactions, so for example, that certain data can be received, but this is controlled and exactly described what data is. So an information exchange is enabled. For example, access to contact data in the address book, or the access to some other, for example, weather information or so on. This is defined through interfaces, and when the app is installed, the user has to exactly give an allowance that, for example, this app is allowed to access data from the address book, or that this app is allowed to access the localization or others. So the authorization is done here in the two platforms. You see that if there is an app usage, then the user can give detailed authorizations. So the user, this authorizations allow the user to determine what information an app is allowed to access from his or her system. So the commonly requested authorization are for location, getting access to data, location data, getting access to the camera, getting access, camera means also the images which are taken by the camera, access to the address book and the contact there. The authorization requested by an app should be checked. It should be not simply say yes, it should be checked, and it should be limited to that things that are necessary for the app. So be careful in the installation process and make responsible decisions what you allow and what you do not allow. Sometimes if you do not allow some function, if you do not allow to some data, some functionality of the app will be perfected, and so one has to carefully think whether this functionality is more important than giving authorization rights to the app that this functionality can be used. So, but beside of this Google App Store and Apple's App Store and Google Play, there are alternative app stores. There's a great variety you can find where you can app download, particularly for the Android system. There are many of these alternative stores are able. But here comes the problem. To be able to use alternative app stores, one must allow the installation from an unknown source. And this every time is dangerous. If you do not know what is the source of the data, are the data checked, for example, for malicious functionality or others. So usually no extensive checks are done, are carried out for such alternative stores. Here are a list of such stores where you see that there are also, this gives the number of the total samples, and often also malware functionality is found in some of the apps which are provided by these alternative stores. So you should be very careful, best you are not doing it, to take apps, to store apps on your system from such alternative app stores. There is some mobile malware in place, malware that mainly are used for stealing money. Which methods are typically used in this mobile world by means of malware? So for example, premium SMS are sent. Click fraud is performed. Login data are stealed, particularly for online banking. But there are more malicious functionality. For example, location tracking. Theft of private data and information, for example, pictures or contacts. later on, for example, to publish such pictures in the web to blame a person or others. Automatic downloading of other apps is done. These are the typical functionality and ideas behind malware in the mobile world. Here are some examples of such mobile malware attacks. Mobile malware, Dendroid is an application for remote maintenance that can be used, can be misused with malicious content. So Dendroid was developed with the intention of bypassing the Google Play Store security check. And if someone wants to do this, it's clear that there are bad ideas in the back. So malware can be embedded and distributed over benign apps. So apps that provide something good for the people, and in these apps some malware is hidden. So the app contains the following functions. The Dendroid app, it's possible to intercept and to block SMS, to capture photos, to capture videos and sound, to record telephone conversations, to spy out the user. Another example of a mobile malware is ExpensiveWall. That's a new version of the malware family that Trojanizes various apps. In September 2017, security researchers identified 50 different infected apps which were downloaded between 1 million and 4.2 million times. So it's a huge number of people which are affected by this malware by downloading apps where this ExpensiveWall malware was hidden. So malware, this ExpensiveWall malware uses different kinds of obfuscation techniques to evade Google Play's built-in anti-malware protection. So the objective of that malware is to register victims to premium services, to send premium SMS messages, to take their money without that the people are aware of this. The vulnerability in the mobile operating systems, I already mentioned this point when we start to discuss about mobile malware. Not only malware apps are a security risk for a mobile system, but also vulnerabilities of the mobile operating system. So the problem with the freely available Android system is that it is often customized by smartphone manufacturers that install their own functionality to get users attracted to buy their smartphone. And this additional functionality makes it difficult to update the operating system. So the update for such customized system needs to come from the smartphone manufacturer which implemented such customized functionality. So often an update for an Android system is available, but cannot be taken for systems with this additional functionality, because then this additional functionality is destroyed. Therefore, most Android smartphones do not receive updates, extensive updates, to address the weaknesses. iOS usually only runs on Apple devices like iPhone and iPad. So this is simplifying the development of updates. So here, as soon as a vulnerability is known, an update can be produced to resolve this attack possibility. So most devices can receive regular updates as long as the device is still supported. Also here we see a problem that many people use old devices, that many people use devices with old operating system, with old iOS systems, which are not updated. Here are some common vulnerabilities in Android systems. So the stage fright 2.0 vulnerability affects the multimedia server component of Android. It makes it possible to abuse this vulnerability via MMS messages, and any app that's supporting this multimedia content. The stage fright malware enables the execution of malware and the extension of rights, the extension of rights without knowledge of the user. So all Android versions prior to version 5.1.1 were vulnerable by this vulnerability, and if one counts the systems, then more than 1 billion devices are affected. This was an estimation in October 2015. From this vulnerability, so you see the recent version is 8, so one should update also operating systems version. Similar vulnerabilities are discovered and patched by Google. So every month up to two new patches are available, but you see the patches are available 2 years later than it was seen and distributed. So phone manufacturers often do not apply security updates from Google for the Android systems because of the already mentioned functionality, customized functionality, and this gives an additional problem that all the vulnerabilities that are already found and that could be patched remain unpatched due to this attitude. What are protective measures to protect your mobile system? First, protect data. Protect data in the case of theft of the device, in case of an attack, so that you can restore your data. This is connection data, these are messages and other systems. Then one should enable encryption as long as this is possible. One should use the smartphone with a PIN, with password, that the password is needed to unlock. This prevents if people are able to steal your smartphone, then they not immediately have access to the data, to your personal data that are stored on the device. Then update apps, update operating system. Most of the recent apps, they have a mechanism to automatically update themselves as an update is available, but one can switch off these mechanisms. Here, to have regular updates of the apps and of the operating system, one should allow this. When purchasing a device, ensure that the operating system is still supported and corresponding updates are available. Sometimes there are some devices, it seems very cheap to buy this device, but if one checks this device, one finds out that the operating system, which is installed on that mobile device, is not a recent one, is an old one, and even worse, it belongs to a group of versions that are no more supported. That means that are no more patches are provided for that system. Then install, that's very important, install apps only from trustworthy sources. Install and download apps only from Google Play Store or from Apple's App Store, because these are official stores, there is a large security mechanism behind. So if these vendors, if Google or Apple allow that the apps are stored and distributed over their stores, then they have a lot of mechanisms in place to guarantee that these apps are not that they do not contain malware. Then look closely at authorization requests by each app. Not simply say yes, see exactly what's necessary, which data are needed, use good passwords, be sure that it's not stored, the password, that's when people can theft your smartphone, that they can get access to your online banking, restrict unnecessary authorizations. So similar, also only use apps that you really need. So this is a couple of protective measures, and absolute security is impossible. But if you follow this advices, it helps you to have a better feeling about the security of your system. And if you're in doubt, then with an app that something is wrong or you have not a good feeling, then search for an alternative app if you need it. So this will help you to prevent attacks by mobile malware.